In this video, we're going to take a look at the first half of the viewport toolbar. And specifically, we're going to go right up to the point where the viewport types end. So right here where you see this S button. We're going to cover everything to the left of this, and then we will actually cover all of the remaining buttons in a future video. So starting here at the left, our very first button is the real-time button. And what this does is it gives you real-time feedback for any animated effects, such as animated materials or particle effects in your scene. So if I come over here and navigate my view over to where we see this little pool of sludge and I hit the real-time button, suddenly we can see everything moving. And just to make things clearer, I'm actually going to hit a button that we'll talk about a little bit later, and that's the maximize viewport button to make my viewport nice and big. So you can see now that this material is moving just as it would in game. If I navigate over here, we have a little weapon locker effect, which you can also see has some motion applied to it. And if I come all the way up to the top floor, we also have a particle emitter, which is also animating because the real-time button is on. If I was to deactivate this, notice that the particles pause in midair, and they will still update just a little bit when I'm moving the camera back and forth.
Right, some of the materials you can see already are starting to move around a little bit. Because what it comes down to is that things will update as the viewport redraws itself, but they won't update at a specific interval. If you want to add a more of a real-time continuous update, you can turn on real-time update.
Yeah, you're basically saying redraw all the time. Now, real-time also has other benefits as well, doesn't it, Logan?
Right, well, one thing it does is make it so that any edit could be seen, you could say, in live mode.
Right.
What that would mean is, as you're dragging an object around, if a viewport is set to real-time, it will reflect those changes immediately instead of waiting until you let go of the object.
That's right. Now, here's a quick demonstration. If I look over on the eastern side of the map, I've got a little teleporter mesh, and you can see this over in the front view as well. I have it selected in both views. Now, what I'm going to do is I'm going to drag it to the left and right here inside the top view, and notice how it doesn't seem to move over in the front view. That's because the front view is not updating. Now, as soon as I let go of the mouse, it jumps. But it might be nice if you could actually see this motion taking place in real time over in the front view. So if I turn on real time feedback in the front view, but then come back to the top view and start moving the object again, you can now see that motion taking place in real time.
Right, it can be very helpful if you're trying to align complex objects together, and you need to see the alignment in multiple axes at the same time.
Exactly. Now, with that, I'm going to turn off real-time in this viewport, and I will go ahead and re-maximize the perspective view. Now, the next button to the right is the unlit movement button. And what this is going to do is, while active, when you move the viewport, you'll notice that all of your lighting information disappears. You neither have light nor do you have shadow. All you're looking at is the raw texture information applied to the materials of the objects in your level. As soon as you stop moving the camera, bink, your lighting comes back. Now, this is very useful if you're in a situation where your level has a lot of dynamic lights and viewport navigation becomes sluggish. You can turn this on and get your speed back. Now, moving on from here, we have an entire section of buttons which allow us to change the view mode of our viewport. And starting at the far left, we have brush wireframe mode. And before I turn that on, I'm going to unmaximize my viewport. And if you take a look at the three orthographic views, you're going to notice that they are already in brush wireframe mode by default. And the purpose of brush wireframe mode is to give you a wireframe of all of your static meshes and whatnot. You can actually see the polygons that make them up. But more importantly, to show you the brushes that are defining the shape of your level. Now, these brushes aren't really the world geometry, are they?
Right. They're instead more of a, you could say, a proxy for geometry. It's what the engine uses to know how to build the geometry and how to put it together, though they aren't the final triangles that end up getting fed to the graphics engine for drawing.
That's right. Now, what I'm going to do is I'm going to turn on brush wireframe mode here in the perspective view and navigate us around a little bit. So, again, our static meshes are popping up in this sort of teal wireframe, but we can also see this blue wireframe here along the outside, and these are the actual brushes that are defining the shape of our level for the game engine to compile world geometry. Now, if we want to actually see this world geometry, if we want to see the geometry that's being used when we play the game, we need to switch out of brush wireframe mode and into wireframe, which is kind of like true wireframe. And here you can see that everything is now divided up into triangles as opposed to big four-sided or quadrangulated shapes, and we can no longer select individual brushes. What we're looking at here is the actual world geometry used by the game for when we play through. So next to this, we have unlit mode, which we've kind of already seen. Let me go ahead and switch over to it. And what this does is this allows you to see your level without any lighting information. Again, you're just looking at the raw texture information. This is very much like unlit movement mode, except where unlit movement is only while you are moving the camera about. true unlit mode just exists all the time. So it's just a way to kill off your lighting. Very handy if you have yet to light a particular scene. You don't want to be bothered with lights. You can just turn this on at any point you like. Now, the next view mode is the default for the perspective view, and that is lit mode. As you have already seen, it allows you to see the result of your lighting and shadows in your map. Very handy to get an idea of what it is your players are going to be looking at, though keep in mind you will often need to rebuild your lighting to see what your lighting is really going to look like when you play the game. And building is something that we'll talk about conceptually in a separate video. Now, moving to the right from this, we have lighting only, a very interesting view mode in which we really only see the result of our lighting.
Right, it's as though a white texture has been applied to everything, allowing us to see the color and shadow of all the lights without any texture information in the way.
That's right, so we lose all of our normal maps, all of our color information. We are just looking at the result of our lights. So a very nice feature there if you're trying to get an idea of what your lights look like. To the right, we have light complexity mode, and this is an interesting mode that allows you to see how the dynamic objects in your scene are being affected by various lights. So what you're going to see when you first turn it on in most levels is everything is going to appear black. And what that means is any object that is receiving a light map or a non-dynamic light is going to appear as black. Other objects, such as dynamic objects, in this case I have a lift over here in the corner, and I'll turn the lights on so you can see it for a second. I have an elevator over here. If we switch back over to light complexity mode, this lift appears yellow, and that is because it is being affected by three lights. If I was to delete out one of these lights, boom, it turns green. If I was to delete out the next light, it turns bright green. So the more lights you add into it, its color is going to shift over toward a red spectrum.
Right, it's more of a help to try to indicate where dynamic lighting might be slowing the level down. In the case of this lift, the lift itself has to be dynamic because, of course, it moves.
That's right.
But we can use this mode to see how many lights are affecting it, and therefore how performance intensive is this part of the scene.
That's right, and the more black you generally see in your level, the better, because those black areas are being affected by static light, which doesn't take anywhere near as much processing power. Alright, moving over to the right from here, we have texture density mode, which is cool. It almost looks like a thermographic vision style mode. But what this is this allows you to visualize how dense the resolution of your textures is on each object in your level. Now, what do I mean when I say dense? Well, if we come over here and take a look at these columns, you'll see that they are bright red, and the wall next to it is blue. In general, your color range for this mode is going to range from blue all the way up to red. So it moves through the cool spectrum up into greens and then into yellows and oranges and all the way up to red. And it changes by how close or high resolution your textures are. If your textures are very large, very spread out and kind of smeared out, then it's going to appear very blue. The tighter your textures get, the more red it's going to become.
Right, basically if you had a very small texture stretched across a large surface, you would get a blue color.
Right.
If you took a very high resolution texture and squashed it into a very small area of space, you would get red in this mode.
Now what I'm going to do is demonstrate this by turning on unlit mode, and let's take a look at this blue wall. And if I put the camera right up on it, you can see that the texture is actually starting to pixelate a little bit. You can see actual pixels of the color information. It doesn't really look all that good. But if I come over here to this column, we can get right up on the column and still make out intricate details because the texture is much tighter, has a much higher resolution here on this object. Now what I'm going to do just to kind of show you how this works is we're going to focus on this little crate here. Let me go back into texture density mode, and you'll notice it's kind of a pale blue. I'm going to select it. Now we can't see that it's selected just because we don't see it actually turn blue like it does when it's selected in lit mode. But if I scale this down by changing its draw scale, let's say down to 0.5, ooh, it shifted from blue to green. That's because the exact same amount of texture which was once on a large object is now on a smaller object. So the texture itself has a much higher density. It's actually a higher resolution texture for the size of the object. Now, if I was to scale this down again, maybe down to 0.2, it turns yellow. If I scale it down again to 0.1, it actually becomes red. So you can see the spectrum start to shift as we go through the various scales of texture. Now, why is this important? Well, it's important to have the high resolution textures in your level resting on important objects that you want the player's attention to be drawn to. You don't want to waste texture processing on objects that are out of the way or maybe aren't a major focus for your level. Also, it might look bad if you're in a situation where you have a very high resolution texture object next to a very low resolution texture object. It can break the realistic feel of your level. So it's a great diagnostic tool for finding problems like that and getting you in a position where you can start to solve them. Now, next to this, we have the shader complexity view mode. So, Logan, why don't you tell us in a nutshell what shader complexity is
going
to do?
Well, what it's going to do, technically speaking, is it's going to analyze how many instructions each shader requires for every pixel inside of the scene. Now, what that really boils down to is how much work is your graphics card having to do to render each of these materials that are on different surfaces, each of these shaders, where green represents very few instructions and red and a shift towards red represents more instructions that are required in order to render that specific pixel.
Right, so we can see that this door is pretty high cost. It's kind of an expensive shader where the walls are generally pretty green. And we can see everything that's kind of hardcore here. Now, this guy looks a little bit different. I think it's because he was moved or something. But as we move around, you can get an idea of where a lot of your shader processing is coming from and on what objects you're getting the most processing on. So a very nice mode for figuring that out. Now, I'm going to go ahead and switch back to lit mode for a second. And there's actually another viewport mode that is kind of hidden. It's only slaved to a hotkey, but you should know about it anyway. It is game mode, and it's attached to your G key on your keyboard. And if you hit this, well, it looks like everything got really blurry. That is because of a post-processing effect that gives you motion blur when you move the camera. If the same thing happens to you, just turn on real-time mode, and then you'll never get that problem again. You will notice while you're in game mode, though, that all of your little game sprites, things like your lights, any path nodes you might have had, any triggers, or any other actors that are visible in your map, suddenly disappear. Because now you are looking at your map in the same way that a player might see it. So this is exactly what it'll look like during gameplay. You also have a slight motion blur when you move the camera around too quick, though I'm sure that's not really picking up in the video. As you move the camera around on your end, I'm sure you'll see it, though. So that's a quick look at game mode. Just keep in mind that it's not a very functional mode for level editing. One, because you can't see your actors. Two, when I select an actor, I lose my widget, so I can't really move anything around anymore. You will have to hit G again to get out of game mode so that you can make changes and manipulate objects.
But it is faster than loading the game in order to test. If you're just looking at something from a visual standpoint, it can be very helpful since you can switch it on and off almost instantly.
Oh, absolutely. It's a great feature. So there's a quick look at game mode. Now, the next four buttons we have allow us to change the type of viewport we're looking at. And here in this particular view, you know that we're looking at a perspective viewport, and lo and behold, the P key is depressed, and its tooltip says perspective. Next to this, we have top. If I was to click this, ooh, the screen turns black, and we see nothing. Why is that? Well, we're looking at an orthographic top view, but we're still looking at it in lit mode, which in general means you won't really see anything because lights are going to be occluded. But if I switch over to brush wireframe mode, suddenly we see our level just as we do in the top viewport. In fact, if I unmaximize the view, I now have two top viewports working independently of one another. So let's re-maximize this. I can use these buttons to cycle through the various types of viewports available to me. I can put them into any viewport mode that I like. So, of course, I can switch over to an orthographic view and switch over to wireframe or brush wireframe. It's very nice if you want to leave one viewport maximized and you don't necessarily want to have to unmaximize to switch over to another view. You can very quickly just jump over to any other type of viewport you want. It's also very handy if for some reason you decide that you need more than one perspective view. Like, let's say I put this guy in perspective, let's put him into lit, and I'll put him in game mode. And then we'll come down to the lower left quadrant. We'll also put this into perspective. I'll put this into, lighting only mode, and I'll put it into game mode to hide all my actors, but I'm going to make it look somewhere else. And then we'll put this guy into a perspective view as well, and we'll leave him in wireframe mode, and I'll make him look over here. So you can start to see where being able to really work with these viewports and put them into different styles or different viewport types can really help you out.
All right, that does also underline the fact that all four viewports are in fact independent of one another. So even if you start to switch them to similar settings, they are still in fact their own viewport.
That's right. Now that is going to wrap everything up for this particular video. In the part two of this series, we're going to actually cover the rest of the viewport toolbar. So thanks a lot.